think it's
Good morning. It's good to be here this morning. It's raining good. I'm glad you made it in here. We'll just keep going until the rain stops, if that's okay with you. But I didn't hear any amens on that. That's all right. I am glad you're here to worship with us this morning, and it's Thanksgiving season, or maybe you've already got your Christmas tree up. But either way, we're glad you're here. And if you're a guest here this morning, there's a card in the pew in front of you and ask you to fill out, and you can drop that in the offering plate just so we have a record of your visit, and we can stay in touch with you. We do have a few things coming up over the Christmas season. In the holiday season, I want to draw your attention to in the bulletin. This Wednesday, of course, we're having no services because of Thanksgiving, and tonight we'll have a regular Sunday night studies, but no services this Wednesday, and the office will be closed later this week as well. We have our Thinkability Christmas party. We have lots of ways to sign up, and you can serve, of course. That's one way that we can help serve the special needs community in our area, and so we'll have a sign up in the lobby. You can keep an eye out on Church Center for things that we might need. On the 17th, we're going to have a Christmas cookies and concert, and the cookies are after the concert, I should say, so you don't get confused. But if you have a Christmas song you like to share with the church or something, that'll just be time that we can come together and share some special music of the season. And also, we'll be doing a Lottie Moon post office. If you don't know what that is, the Lottie Moon offering is an offering that Southern Baptist churches take up every Christmas, and every penny that is taken up with that offering goes directly to missionaries on the mission field. It doesn't pass through any hands, and nobody takes an administrative cut, and the church doesn't, and the International Mission Board doesn't, or anything like that. Lottie Moon was a missionary who gave her life to China, spent decades there, and she suggested that we take up an offering at Christmas, and we've been doing that for over 100 years since then. And so the Lottie Moon post office works by, instead of sending Christmas cards to people in the church, you can come here and put them in the back. There'll be some boxes or baskets in the back, and you can put them there, and the money that you saved on postage, you can give that to the offering. And then kids and others will help deliver those within the church. I might help deliver them because I'm still trying to learn names, and that'll help me do that. But as we said, all the proceeds go to international missions. Then this year, Christmas Eve is on a Sunday. We normally have a Christmas Eve candlelight service. We're going to do that Sunday morning. We'll have one special service at 10, and then we'll have music and worship and candlelight and all that thing in that service, and no service that evening. But I'm glad you're here. Why don't you stand up and shake hands with those around you, and then we'll get started.
Thank you.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort which we ourselves are comforted by God. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins they are many, His mercy is more.
Our sins are many, but His mercy is more. As our ushers come for our offering, I just want to let you know of a couple of needs that we have in our community, things that you can be praying for. We have several in the hospital. You can go ahead and have a seat. Many of you know the Blankenship family and Liam in the hospital. And many of you ask about my dad, who has been there also in the heart hospital. Ask you to keep praying for him. We have other needs over Thanksgiving where families are traveling and people are moving. The Harpers, it's their last Sunday today. Make sure and say something to them. We have all of these needs and these things over our lives, and the offering is a time. It's my desire. The offering is not just something we do while we do something else, but a time that we stop and we remember what Christ has done for us. And so I ask you today is, if you have been blessed, you put in. And if you have a need, you tell me or tell one of the deacons or elders, and we'd be happy to try to help you meet that need in any way that we can. Would you pray with me? Dear Father God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this time we have together. Father, I thank you for even in the midst of transition and changes and all of these things going on, Father, that we are reminded of all that you have done for us. God, I pray these few dollars that we give, Lord, will be a blessing, Father. Would you take them and multiply them and do something miraculous. We love you, Father. We pray all these things in your name. Amen. I'm going to read you this morning from Psalm 72. He says, "Give the king your judgments, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your afflicted with justice. Let the mountains bring peace to the people and the hills in righteousness. May he vindicate the afflicted of the people, save the children of the needy, and crush the oppressor. Let them fear you while the sun endures, as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he come down like rain upon the grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may the righteous flourish in abundance of peace till the moon is no more. May he rule from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. Let the nomads of the desert bow before him and lick the dust. Let the kings of Tarshish and islands bring presents and Sheba offer gifts, and let all the kings bow down before him, all the nations serve him. For he will deliver the needy when he cries for help, the afflicted also, him who has no helper. He has compassion on the poor and the needy. The lives of the needy he will save. He rescues their life from oppression and violence, and their blood will be precious in his sight. So may he live, and may the gold of Sheba be given to him. Let them pray for him continually and bless him all day long. May there be abundance of grain in the earth on top of the mountains, wave like the cedars of Lebanon, and those from the city flourish like vegetation of the earth. May his name endure forever. May his name increase as long as the sun shines, and let men bless themselves by him. Let all nations call him blessed. Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who alone works wonders, and blessed be his glorious name forever. May the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen." Your Father, there we come together with all the nations to bless your name and to praise you, Father. Your name endures forever. Lord, even as the seasons change, remind us of the changing nature of the world around us and the change we see in all of our own lives and the needs we have of those in the hospital and recovering from surgery and facing illness, Father. Your name endures forever. Lord, may your name increase as long as the sun shines. Blessed be you, O God of Israel. You alone works wonders, Father. I pray that the whole earth would be filled with your glory. I pray that you would start by filling our hearts, Father, and fill our families, Father, and fill this church and fill our community, and Father, and let wave after wave of your glory go forth and cover the earth. We love you, Father. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
Would you stand and worship with us this morning?
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living Lord. Yeah. came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe, and out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim.
Stay. He was.
throne. I stand in incomplete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat that Jesus paid it all, and all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Yes, He as we just sing this last song, I want to call us to Psalm 7. It says, I will give to the Lord the thanks due to His righteousness, and I will sing praise to the name of the Lord, the Most High. Before we even sing this last song, we sang it last week, it says, thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus. It's washed me white, just as we just sang, and Jesus paid it all. And thank you, Jesus, you've saved my life and brought me from the darkness into glorious light. We're entering this week of Thanksgiving, and before we even start singing, I want us to take a moment to just recognize and thank the Lord in a place that we've seen Him in our life be faithful, be who He said He is over and over again. This morning, our worship team had a time to just reflect on who God is, reflect on His goodness. And so I want to give you a second this morning to say thank you, God, whether it's been that He's constantly beside you and with you in the times where you feel lonely, or maybe you're saying thank you, God, for your blood that you've applied this morning. So I want to give us some space to do that as we before we sing this last song. I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. And sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time, I had hope. In our sin, you didn't leave us in the darkness, Lord, but God, that you paid the price through your son Jesus, God, that our debt was paid on the cross through the blood of Jesus, Lord, and that we can sing in the victory, God, and we can sing of the light that you've brought us into, God. I pray, Lord, that you speak this morning through Luke as he comes to speak, and that we listen closely to your word, God, that you've delivered us, God, from our enemies, Lord, and so I pray, Lord, that our hearts are listening closely to your word this morning, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You can have a seat. Sarah and I had not been married very long. I was working as a youth pastor at a church, and unfortunately, it ended poorly there. Some things were said about me that just weren't true, and I left the church, and I forgave the pastor who said those things about me, who lied about me and the church, and God led us to a better place, and I moved on from it all. Then years later, that same pastor approached me at False Creek and said, "Hey, can I talk to you in private?" And he came up to me and said, he said, "I was wrong. What did I do to you?" He said, "I lied. I made those things up. And God has dealt with me about it, and I need to ask your forgiveness. Will you forgive me?" he said. And I got to be honest, I didn't really know what to say. I had forgiven him, or so I thought, but now that he wanted forgiveness, I didn't want to give it to him. You know that feeling? I enjoyed being the bigger person. But now that he admitted wrongdoing, I wanted to hold the debt over him. And I realized that forgiveness is something that's easy to say and hard to do. We've come to the end of the Lord's Prayer. That story is just one out of thousands I have of my own life where it proves it's hard to forgive. That's what makes the words of Christ so powerful in the Lord's Prayer. We'll continue today again in the Lord's Prayer. You'll see the verses up there on the screen. Matthew chapter 6, starting in verse 9. Let's read it aloud together like we have been. "Pray then in this way: Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." The phrases in the Lord's Prayer all kind of run together, as you see, but it is one coherent thought. Forgive us, focus us, provide for us, lead us. It's a prayer of leaning on God and understanding our problems and needs, and that's particularly true in these couple of phrases we're looking at. These are all strung together. We stopped last week at "Give us our daily bread." Stick those verses back up there. We stopped at that part about "Give us our daily bread," but you see there in verse 11, "And forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. Do not lead us in temptation, but deliver us from evil." You know, in the original Bible, there was no verses or chapters. Jesus didn't say, "On earth as it is in heaven," verse 11. "Give us this day our daily bread," verse 12. It's just one coherent thought. It's a reminder that our need for God goes far beyond our physical needs. The greatest need any of us has is a spiritual need. God provides for that too. These things are different. One's about the physical body and one about our spiritual body, but we're still reliant on God for all our provisions. And as strong as our need is for daily bread, our need for forgiveness is even greater. Our need for spiritual forgiveness is greater than your need for physical bread. You know how much you need bread. You know how you get kind of hangry if you go a long time without eating, right? You know that feeling. You know we all need to eat to live, but without forgiveness from sins, we die forever. When we think about prayer, this is the kind of thing that most of us think about. Asking God for something, petitioning God for one thing or another. He asks for physical and spiritual things. It's good and right to petition God for your needs. This passage teaches us plainly, and I said it plainly last week, and I want to say it again. God loves to meet your needs. He wants to ask you, he wants you to ask him to meet your needs. It bears repeating as we talk about forgiveness and others too. God wants you to bring your needs to him. And part of the good news of this prayer is that God never tires of us coming to him. Can you believe that? Have you ever had a child, or maybe when you were a child, you've gone up to your parent and they said, I know I've asked you this before, but... And as a parent, what do you say? Well, my answer probably hasn't changed. And you get tired. You say, don't bring that up to me again. I've already answered that question. I'm not going to tell you again. Never once have you come to God and he says, oh, not this again. Not him again. Not her again. Not this mess again. Are you still bothering me about those same old things? God never says that. He loves for you to pray to him. What do we pray about? The whole Lord's Prayer teaches us that, of course, but three words here I want to draw your attention to, three key words or sets of words, and the first one is forgive us. God instructs us to pray for him to forgive us. The part of the prayer teaches we need forgiveness from God. In case we didn't know it, this prayer is a reminder of that. Every one of us is born in sin, separated from the holiness of God by our sin. Sin disrupts the relationship we're meant to have with God, but thankfully, he has provided a way for us back to him through forgiveness. The Apostle John wrote to the early church. He said this, my little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He himself is the propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for those of the whole world. John the Apostle wrote this probably in his old age. He writes, my little children. These are people that he loves dearly. And he says, I'm giving you these instructions so that you can avoid sin, but there's good news. If you do sin, when you sin, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He's the propitiation, the payment for our sins. And not only for ours, his blood is sufficient for those of the whole world, for anyone who believes in him. Every single one of us can be brought back into right relationship with God through Jesus on the cross. Forgive us our debts. You know, when we pray that in the Lord's Prayer, it's not just words. And we say it so rote, so repetitiously. But when we pray, forgive us our debts, it is a plea for mercy from the God of the universe. Forgive us our debts. I'm calling on you, great and mighty and holy King of Kings, forgive me. I've committed treason against you. In your kingdom, I have tried to usurp your throne and place myself there. Forgive me. And he does it every time. We're not only asking God for forgiveness, we're asking God to give us the strength to forgive others who have wronged us. We are both sinned against, and we sin against God. It means there are people in your life who do not give you what you are due, what you are owed. They are in your debt, as it were. Forgive us our debts. Forgive us our sins. Every single one of us owes a debt to God, and every single one of us is owed a debt to others. But outside of all of this stands God. He is a debtor to no man. He owes no one nothing. Everyone owes him. And we are told to go to Jesus and ask him for forgiveness. Boy, what a wild word forgiveness is. I just signed a mortgage on a house, signed my life away. And imagine me going to them and saying, I really think you should forgive this debt. They say, why? Well, I'm a really nice guy, you know? And, you know, look, I've got kids, and I'd really like to buy a new car with this money instead. And what would I do? I'd be laughed out of the room. But Jesus instructs us to go to God and make a far bigger ask. He's saying, not only are we asking him to forgive us for what we have failed to pay in the past, but confessing we don't have what it takes in the future either. We cannot get in God's graces by working off the debt. There is no way, because forgiveness is not about removing the debt. It's about restoring our relationship. We know that because of what he prays in the next one. Forgiveness not only restores our relationship with God, but with our fellow neighbors as well. And he says, and make sure and pay close attention, ask for forgiveness. It's a very specific word. We're not told to overcome the sin of others or overlook them or ignore them. He says, forgive them. We're not to work harder to appease God or be in his graces. We're to ask forgiveness. Forgiveness means separation, to hurl away, to put it away, to leave it alone, to disregard, to put it off. It's a total detachment or separation. As far as the east is from the west, the Bible says, so far has God removed our sins from us. If you started off from here and started walking east, whatever direction that is, east, you would keep walking east forever. You would never turn around and start walking west. If you start going north, eventually you'll hit the North Pole and come back around. But he says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our sins from us. Our English word forgive doesn't really give an adequate picture of the Greek word. We say we forgive someone who has wronged us. We usually mean any feeling of animosity we had or something like that. It's changed to friendliness. That pastor who came to me and said, "Will you forgive me?" I really hadn't forgiven him. I had just forgot about it, because when I saw him again, it all came back. And then he said, "Will you forgive me? Will you remove this debt from me? Will you put it away as far as the east is from the west, so that you never associate me and this wrong that I have done to you again?" Well, that's a big ask. As far as the act as itself is concerned, we cannot do anything about it. It's been done, and we think we cannot move on. But Jesus means something else. He means for the sin to be removed from us, to be taken away from our account, that it's no longer attached to our name, that we need forgiveness that Jesus is offering. Forgiveness doesn't come down on this list in the Lord's Prayer as if it's of last importance. We're driven to our knees by the goodness of God and what He has done for us. Missionaries, a story is told in northern Alaska. They were translating the Bible into the language of the Eskimos. There was no word in their language for forgiveness. You know, missionaries run into these things sometimes. After much patient listening, they discovered a word that means not being able to think about it anymore. That word was used in the translation to represent forgiveness, because God's promise to repentant sinners, God's promise to you and to me is this: I will forgive their iniquity, I will remember it no more. I will not hold on to it until it's not forgetting about it until He sees us again, until we come to the altar or we go to pray, we have a need and we come to Him. It's none of those things. It's that He removes us from it. To be forgiven by God is to have our sins removed from us. It's not that He looks at us and says, "Yeah, they're a sinner, but I forgive them." It's that our sins have been removed from us. This is a miracle. He removes it from us, hurls it away, it says, separates it from us. This is what we're praying for. God, forgive me. Not overlook it. I don't want God to say, "Well, they tried hard, I'll give them this one." We boldly approach the throne of grace and say, "God, I need forgiveness." It's a conscious choice. It's not mere forgetting. He looks right at us and forgives us. And then He calls us to do the same for others. The same forgiveness that we have been granted by Christ, the same removal and separation of our sins, of our debts, is what we are to offer others. And then, as if that were not enough, Jesus instructs us, ask more from God. This part of the phrase gets lost, and He says other temptations, but verse 13 says, "Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil." It's a miraculous phrase, "lead us." It means we have given up control of our lives. Praying for God to lead us means we're giving it all over to God. It means we've given up control of our lives, and we're giving it all over to God. Lead us. One of the strange things about being new to town is that everyone has opinions about the fastest way to get somewhere. You got to go down this road, they say. Don't go that road. That stoplight's slow. You have to cut by here. You have to go by there. Everybody's got opinions. Even Google has multiple opinions. On different days, I'll ask it, it'll say different things, right? Everybody has an idea about the best way. You know that feeling if you live here for most of your life? You know these roads like the back of your hand, right? Me, right now, I don't know anything. I've gotten that the streets have numbers and trees, and that's about all I got, right? I know that the church is Second and Oak. I can't even remember it's just a tree, because it could be birch or aspen or any of these things, right? I know that so when I need to get somewhere that I've not been before, I ask somebody, "Lead me." I ask Google Maps to guide me. What's interesting about this phrase, "lead us," is it implies there are other options. As in, it's not necessarily mandatory, we would say, or compulsory to follow God. We know that's not true because none of us have been following God our whole lives. Our testimony is a story of our life before Christ when we were following other things we thought were right in the world. But in our lives, the stakes are much higher. Around here, I'm just trying to get to HTO the fastest way possible. But in my life, I'm trying to find success, happiness, wealth, power, control, family, love. And let me tell you, everyone's got an opinion on how I find those things. They told me to take this shortcut, to go this way, to not listen to what other people say they don't know, but to trust them. There is no shortage of the number of people who are willing to tell you the direction that you should take your life. But what does Jesus say about himself in John 14? He said, I am the way and the truth and the life. There is no way to the Father but through me. So we are not left to our own devices to find our own way around the world. Nor are we to work our way and go to others and ask them what the best option is. We turn to God's Word, we turn to Jesus Christ, and He instructs us to do that through prayer, and we pray this at the beginning of verse 13, lead us. Honestly, the way I hear this prayer in my mind, it's almost a prayer of desperation. Think about those moments in life when you don't know the right thing to do. You're dealing with an aging parent, and somebody says, in your family, well, what are we going to do about it? And all you can do is say, lead me, Lord. You're graduating high school and you're supposed to pick a career for your life. And everyone says, what are you going to do with your life? And all you can do is say, Lord, lead me. You're dealing with wayward children. You're dealing with the health crisis of a loved one. You're trying to think about what school you should go to. You're thinking about your own health and mortality and what the doctor just told you. And here's what Jesus tells us to pray. Lead us. And I really love that us part because it means we are seeking God together. I'm not supposed to cloister myself off and figure out what God wants. I'm to seek advice and counsel and wisdom. But I need to make sure, of course, all of it comes from the Bible. We're making the decision about whether or not to move here and uproot our family and change churches. I had to ask myself lots of important questions like, where is Duncan? And what kind of restaurants are there? And do we want to go there, right? All of these things. But in these big life decisions, we need counsel, don't we? Thankfully, God has given me and given you wise mentors and friends that we can call for advice. And hopefully that call us when the situation arises. That's the beauty of that phrase, lead us. Remember, everything in the Lord's Prayer is plural. Forgive us, lead us, give us our daily bread. All of these plural meanings that give the idea that we are not in this alone. We are seeking God together. This is what a church is. We are together, working to follow after God together. Praise God for that. Forgive us, we pray. Lead us, we pray. But there's one more thing, he says, deliver us. When you go to read commentaries or other studies on this verse, they always get in the part about leading us into temptation. That's kind of draws our attention. We'll get there in a minute, but that's not what he says first. He says, deliver us. The part of the phrase gets lost in the temptation part, but it's a miraculous phrase. It implies we've given up control of our lives, lead us. We've given it over to God. We don't decide where to go. We don't decide what to do with our lives. God does. It's an important prayer, not just for us to have the strength to overcome. It's about God. It's not even about God giving us the strength to do it ourselves. It's about God doing it for us. You deliver me, God. You don't say, Lord, give me the strength to overcome and work my way up and claw myself out of this pit. We pray, God, deliver me. Have you ever heard the phrase, God helps those who help themselves? That's unbiblical foolishness. So is the phrase, God doesn't give us more than we can handle. If we can handle it, then why would we need God? God doesn't give us all these things. He doesn't give us evil or sin or abuse or cancer or any of these things. He delivers us. He leads us through them, not for our sake, but for His glory. We don't need deliverance from the hard times of the world either. We need deliverance from sin because the allure of the world is so overwhelming So much so, we need God's grace to deliver us. Being free from sin is not about everything we can do on our own. You don't have the strength in you to overcome your sin. You understand what it means to be a sinner. A dog is not a dog because it barks, right? He barks because he's a dog. That's what they do. It's in his nature. In the same way, you are not a sinner because you sin. As if you could stop sinning, you would no longer be a sinner. You sin because you are a sinner. It is your nature. It is what you do. You cannot help but to avoid it. Every single one of us in here, if this is your 10,000th time in church or your first time, you are a sinner fallen short of the glory of God. But he has promised us a way out. God doesn't tempt us. James makes that clear. He says, don't say God is tempting us. But Paul is also clear. God provides a way out. We're faced with evil. Look at these verses. He says, blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. For once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil. He himself does not tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. We pray for God to deliver us from evil. Do not lead us into temptation. Helps to remember the spirit of the word. In the word temptation is not just about a lure to sin. God does not lead us to sin. The word tempt is the idea of trying or testing or proving something. When a new ship is released in the water full of cargo and passengers, before that it's approved, it is tested. Before an anchor becomes the only hope of a vessel in the middle of a storm, it has to be tested and tried. The Bible says God proved Abraham or tested him. He put his faith and obedience to the test. Jesus was tempted before he began his public ministry, proving he could be a deliverer. Jesus is the one who overcomes temptation. You and I don't have the strength to do that, so we pray to God, deliver us. We've prayed, forgive us. We've prayed, lead us. And now we pray, deliver us. I am asking you, God, do what I cannot do myself. When trials come, when the testing of our faith happens, we're asking God to keep us close to him. You remember the old hymn, we've sung it here sometimes. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Take my heart, Lord, like a fetter. Bind my wandering heart to thee. He says, deliver me. God, I'm prone to wander, I know it. I'm going to wander away. When we say, do not lead us into temptation, we're saying, God, bind my heart to you. Deliver me from evil. Deliver me from myself. Bind my heart to you like a prisoner in a chain with a fetter. He says, God, keep us close to you. We know the proclivity in our own hearts, and so we have to stay close to God. And this is what that prayer does. Some points of application. What do we do? Some of you need to ask for forgiveness for the first time. It's pretty straightforward. Some of you are sinners. You have never asked Christ for forgiveness. You might have thought about it. You might have been in church for a while or anything else, but you need to go to God today. You need to confess your sin. You need to say, I'm a sinner. I admit that I have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I believe that Jesus Christ came to die for my sins, and I confess that I need you to live and rule over my life. You can say those words just as I said them. There's nothing magical about it. It's just admitting, believing, and confessing in your heart that Christ is Lord. You can find the forgiveness that you need to. If you have never done that for the first time, if that is you here, I urge you to do that today. Now the second one. This is the harder one. You need to forgive others. It's probably especially important in a church, in any church. Has anyone offended you? You need to forgive them. Has anyone here hurt you? You need to forgive them. Has anyone done you wrong? You need to let it go. You need to release that sin, that debt against you. Remove it from them as far as Christ removes your sin from you. If I can be honest, I've been anxious about this sermon because I've noticed there's a lot of hurt in this church. There's a lot of hurt over actions, over things done, over things said, over things not said. Believe me, I know church hurt is some of the worst hurt. I opened with that story about my own church hurt. I still bear wounds from that. But we got to let it go. And I'm not saying that wrong things didn't happen. I'm not saying that everything was handled perfectly by anybody, you or anyone else. But I'm saying you cannot heal from that hurt without forgiving them. I challenge you right now to think about somebody who hurts you. A parent, a friend, a church member, a church leader. Pray for the strength to forgive them. It might not be in the church. It might be something you've been holding on to for decades. It might be something somebody said to you a long time ago. They might not have even meant it. It might have just been a misspoken word, a careless thought or phrase, but you carried that with you for a long time. We're coming up to Thanksgiving. You know how that goes. If you're like my family, you've already been in the group text and people are mad about this and about that, let it go. Forgive them. And you might say, you don't know what they did to me, and I don't. And you don't know the hurt I've pained, and you don't know how long I held on to this, and you don't know. I don't know, but God does. Jesus knows what you did to him, and he still forgives you. He said, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they do. Even out of ignorance, he offered forgiveness on the cross. Think about that person who hurt you. It's not easy to forgive them. And maybe when I said that, just somebody immediately came to mind. Maybe they're here. Don't look their way, okay? Maybe they came to mind. But I urge you, forgive them. Let them go. Remove. Don't just forget about it until you see them at Thanksgiving again or at church again or at some other function. Remove it as far as the east is from the west. As far as God has removed our sins from us, you remove the sin from that person. You are forgiving them as Christ has forgiven you. He says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. These people who owe something against us, who did not give us what we deserve, who did not treat us right. And I know this world is a hard, cruel place. But this phrase, forgive us our debts, it covers misspoken words. It covers intentional abuse. It covers hardships and trials and sufferings of all sorts of things imaginable. But Jesus teaches us to pray this way. Forgive us, Lord, and help us forgive them. We need to forgive others in order to be led away from temptation and evil. There is not a person in here who does not need to pray this way. No matter where you are, no matter how far you've gotten in life, you need to pray this way. Because the temptations of this world are strong. You cannot overcome them on your own. Well, I have a time of invitation in a moment. You might need to come to the altar, and that's all that you can pray. Lord, deliver me. Maybe with whatever you're facing, all that you can pray is, Lord, lead me. You need to quit trying to do things on your own. Quit trying to make it on your own. Quit trying to overcome that sin on your own. Quit trying to make it through life. Let go of those things. Go to God and ask for deliverance. Ask for freedom. Ask God for what you cannot do yourself, because you have a Father who loves to meet your needs. You might have heard the name of Corrie Ten Boom. She worked against the Nazis in World War II. She and her family, they hid Jews in their home. She was caught, her family. She was sent to a concentration camp, stripped of her dignity. She saw her father and her sister die in front of her. She suffered at the hands of people more than we can possibly imagine. That's why her encounter with forgiveness is so memorable. She says, at a church service in Munich, I saw him. She said, the former SS man who had stood guard at the shower in the door of the processing center in Ravensbrück. He was the first of our actual jailers that I had seen since that time, and suddenly it was all there. The room full of mocking men, the heaps of clothing, my sister's pain-drenched face. She said, he came up to me as the church was emptying. This was after the war, beaming and bowing. How grateful I am for your message, Fraulein, he said. To think that, as you say, he has washed my sins away. And then she said, he shook out his hand, thrust out his hand to shake mine. She said, and I, who preach so often to the people about the need to forgive, I kept my hand at my side, and even as the angry, vengeful thoughts boiled through me, I could see the sin of them too. Jesus Christ had died for this man. Was I going to ask for more? Lord Jesus, I prayed, forgive me and help me to forgive him. She says, I tried to smile. I struggled to raise my hand. I could not. I felt nothing, not the slightest spark of warmth or charity. Again, I breathed a silent prayer. Jesus, I cannot forgive him. Give me your forgiveness. She said, as I took his hand, the most incredible thing happened. From my shoulder, through my arm, through my hand, a current seemed to pass from me to him, and into my heart sprang love for the stranger that almost overwhelmed me. And I discovered, she says, it is not in our forgiveness any more than our goodness that the world's healing hinges, but on Christ. When he tells us to love our enemies, he gives it along with the command to love itself. Here's the thing about forgiveness. It can be hard, but it is not in our forgiveness that the world's healing hinges, but on his. We're given the opportunity to participate in this love that Jesus extends to the world with our forgiveness. This is a good encouragement. Christ gives us the love that we need to forgive others. He says, forgive us. He teaches us to pray, forgive us, lead us, and deliver us. And I don't know what's going on in your life, and I don't know who you are struggling to forgive, but I pray you might find encouragement in that story to find the forgiving love of Jesus in your life to offer to others. As we pray, you might need to ask for forgiveness for the first time. You can do that today. I will be down here. Some others will be down here standing at the front. If you want to come talk to them, somebody you know better, you need to come and ask for forgiveness for the first time. You do that. Maybe you also need to ask for forgiveness, not for the first time. We use the word rededicate, but that word really isn't in the Bible. It's repent is what you're doing. Maybe there's somebody else you need to forgive. Maybe it's me. Maybe it's someone else. Whatever it is, forgive them. Let it go. Remove that sin from them. Restore the relationship and pray for this church. I urge you to come to the altar and pray for this church that we won't let hardships define us, that we would be bound together in Christ, that even when difficulties do come, you've not known me long enough for me to disappoint you, but I will. And when I come, when that happens, I pray that as far as the east is from the west, you'd remove that sin from me. Not through your power, not because you're a great person, but because Christ has forgiven you and you can forgive others. Won't you pray with me? Oh, Jesus, I don't know that I have the words to pray. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us. Father, we all have fallen so short of the glory of God. I have fallen short this week, today, this morning. God, forgive us. Oh God, we need your forgiveness. Lord, some of us have been carrying around that weight of sin and sorrow and debt that we think we owe, and it's crushing us. Father, teach us that we no longer have to carry that. We can come lay it down, that the burden rolls off of us. The burden rolls off of us and straight into the tomb, and the grave swallows it up forever. Oh, Father, I pray. Lord, if there's someone who has not asked forgiveness for the first time, Lord, that they would find the grace to do it today. Just to pray, Jesus, forgive me, I need you. Come and live in my life. Lord, if there is someone who's holding on to something from somebody else, help them to let that go. Lord, I don't know what it is. I don't know the hurts that all of us face, Father, but you do. And bring that person to our mind right now, even that person that we need to forgive, Lord, and give us the strength to do it. Lord, lead us, deliver us, whatever we're facing, wherever we find ourselves, give us the strength to turn to you and lead us where we need to be. We love you, Father. We pray this in your name. Amen. Won't you stand as we sing and you come to the altar and pray as God lays on your heart.
Teach me some melody.
above, praise a mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. And Jesus on me when a stranger wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. To grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be, and let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. I'm prone to
pray as God has laid these things in your heart, and I know if you're like me, somebody came to mind I need to ask for forgiveness from, and the Lord laid on my heart, and I thought, well, that's it, and I'm done. But then somebody else popped up, and somebody else, you know how that goes. But God has forgiven us 1,000 times over, and it's the same grace we can offer to others. If you're not sure about what I've said, if you have questions, and or just you need prayer. You need prayer to let go of something that God has laid in your heart. I urge you to do that this morning. I'll be here at the front or there in the back. You can come and find me or Thane or one of the other elders or anybody, your Sunday school teacher, anybody would be happy to pray with you. If you've not asked for forgiveness from Christ for the first time, do not leave today without doing it. Let's sing that last verse one more time.
Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be, and let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. And prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Well, Father, we offer you our hearts, not only our hearts, but our lives and our minds, our families, our friends, and everything else. Father, I pray that you would take these few simple words that I've said, Father, and use them to move on the hearts of people. Lord, even as we leave this place, I pray, Lord, that you would forgive us, that you would lead us, that you would deliver us. We love you, Father, and we thank you for all that you've done and for all that you're going to do. We pray all this in your name. Amen.